and to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to be. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether worthy, altogether wonderful, altogether wonderful to me.
Well, good morning, everybody, and a very warm welcome to you for our online service here at OB Baptist Church this morning. as it's great to be able to welcome you here, whether you're a regular with us or whether this is your first time. Do feel very welcome to join us. And as you can see, things are a bit different this morning. We've not got Tom, our regular minister. He's on holiday at the moment. So for those that don't know me, my name's Paul Neville, and I'm the secretary here at OBC. So as usual, we've got a few folks taking part in the service this morning, so we're just going to check in and make sure technology is working, particularly as we've got some new faces on this side of the camera this morning. So first of all, Rob, who's going to be leading our sun worship this morning. Morning, Rob. Are you there, Paul? Rob? Good. Hi, Rob. Good to see you. And also we have Andy Brockbank making his live stream debut this morning. Good morning, Andy.
Good morning, Paul. How are you?
We're good. And Andy's going to be preaching later, so we will be back with Andy shortly. And also Leanne, who's going to be leading our service today. Good morning, Leanne.
Good morning, everyone.
So whether you are regular or visiting us, we'd love to hear from you. And as usual, we're going to be using the question and answer feature that's available on Teams. And on screen, you can see how you can either ask a question, but more importantly, just send us a greeting. Let us know that you're watching with us this morning. Or similarly, if there's a particular word of encouragement or a question you've got, feel free to share through that feature. We are going to be using that feature later in the service this morning. So have a look at that, make sure you can use that if at all possible, and it would be great for as many as possible to interact with us in that way. Similarly, if you've got any form of hearing difficulties today and would find subtitles useful, if you are using a desktop or a laptop, then you can turn those subtitles on, just change the settings from off to English, and that will hopefully provide some help for you. We can't guarantee what those subtitles say because they're computer generated, but hopefully that will help you to follow the service this morning. And so with that, I'm going to hand over to Andy, who I believe has a question for us.
Yes, indeed, Paul. So we'd like to get you thinking and also responding this morning. And I'd like you to think about the following question, which I will post in the Q&A so you can see it written down. Why do you think people set themselves tasks or projects during lockdown? I'll repeat that. Why do you think people set themselves tasks or projects during lockdown? If you can think about that and post any reflections in the Q&A, we'll try to pick that up later on. There is a link to the sermon, but there isn't a right answer to this, so you don't need to worry that you might get it wrong. We're interested to hear what people's reflections on that might be. I think now I hand to Leanne.
Yes, hello, and welcome. It's great to be here this morning with all of you. And if you can answer that question, that'd be great, because the more people who put their comments in the box, the more we are as a family and as a congregation, and we can know who's there. So let's see if we can get as many answers as we can to that question. Thank you. I'm going to start with some of Psalm 8 as we glorify the Lord this morning. O Lord, our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise because of your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. And we're here today to find out more about our Lord God and his love for each one of us. And we're going to be doing a series, a sermon series for the next few weeks about a particular man in the Old Testament. And I've got a few clues for you as to who that might be. First of all, I'm in a room with a blue background, so that's a little bit of a clue. And then here's a clue as well. There's just a little fish, or should I say a bigger fish? So you can shout out at the screen what you think today is about. No, Nigel. But yes, it is about Jonah. And not the narwhal, but Jonah and a big fish. And we're going to hear more about Jonah later. Now, today, what we're going to do in a minute is we're going to watch a rap by Paradox. These are the Young Paradox group who performed quite a few years ago. And on this rap, we've put subtitles so that you can read it better because it's quite quick and sometimes it's difficult with the audio. So there are subtitles right at the back at the bottom of your screen for this rap, which Ellen spent time doing. So thank you very much, Ellen, for doing that. As soon as we've finished seeing that, we're then going to sing the song together, The Splendor of the King. So let's enjoy and watch an overview of Jonah during this rap. Off we go.
Once upon a time, on an ordinary day, an ordinary bloke in his workday way was walking around Joppa, a deep-side town, of very little interest to no renown. Jonah was the name of the typical guy who was very much surprised when, up in the sky, the voice of the Lord flew down to the cloud, extraordinary clear and extraordinary loud.
Jonah, I've got a job for you. Something extraordinary for you to do. There's a town across the sea, I've seen a sinner her, so please take a message to the town of Nineveh. 40 more dinners for the city of sinners. 40 days to change yours. Curtains for dinners.
But surely this is some kind of elaborate joke. I'm not prehistoric, you're just a laundry bloke.
You will do.
Says who?
Says me.
You are?
I'm God, so get yourself to Nineveh.
Okay, anything you say.
Go!
But God wanted Jonah was a young man down. God himself burst himself and flows from his feet, gathered out with a lump in his throat, hoping to escape the Lord's protection because the boat's advertised in the opposite direction from Nineveh.
Hey, Nineveh's that way, go!
No!
It seems like a abundantly bigger, of course. But 2 days later, it was bucking like a horse. The crew were deafened by the howling of the gales, and the timbers were shivered from the keels to the bay. The boat turned about like a cork on the deep, but down in the hold, Jonah was asleep.
Rock-a-bye, Jonah, in your bunk bed. When you wake up, you may well be
dead to the world, snoring like a drunk. He slept through the storm, and this time he bumped till the captain woke him up and said,
"Gentlemen, pray that the Lord doesn't make this your last living day."
Up on deck, Jonah faced the crew, who were desperate.
We didn't have a clue.
Jonah was a fully paid-up landlubber. He started to wail, and he started to blubber.
This is all my fault, running off to the Lord. If you want to save yourself, then throw me overboard.
What?
Well,
all right
then.
Waste rush threw him in the ship against sink, so the crew grabbed Jonah and threw him in the drink.
Splash!
The waves died down, the storm crashed in, and quietly bubbling, Jonah disappeared. The crew gave thanks, the ship sailed on, and the order for the chopper was
gone.
Which would have been the end of this fishy tale, if God had sent along a great new whale, deployed in bulk in the mighty fish, finally Jonah away from Tarsus. Jonah flashed around in the cavernous bowl.
Howl, howl, howl!
Echoing howl.
They play rugby in Wales, you know?
Yes, and they have leaks in Wales too.
Leaks? I'm going to drown!
Not that kind of leak, you clown.
3 days later, when time was a verdict, came a heave and a ho and a great big lurk, Jonah found himself face down in the sand, vomited forth in an unknown land. Watching the disappearing gulf of Nineveh, he realized he was lying on the beach at Nineveh. The voice of God struck him like a harpoon.
Ah! As soon as you're told, now you have to act, Jonah!
A wave of fear she got on her boat, but it picked itself up and it put itself down, took the sand from his hands and went into town. Soon he was lost in a crushing sleeve of life fingered juices with knives at their sleeves.
I got an idea that I will speak, but let's put tourists not to as fast as you go.
Let's hotwire some camels and ram into the shops and throw back an exit at Nineveh's cops.
Yes!
There were pimps and pushers and shiters and struts, drugged up, drunk and proper and rough. General on his watch, his wallet.
Am I right?
And 8 seconds later.
Enough is enough!
He's dead right up in the noise in Nineveh and preached in the marketing city of Nineveh.
Ladies and gentlemen! Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen! Ladies and gentlemen!
The crowd stood still.
The Lord has asked me to express his not inconsiderable displeasure and his willingness to exact retribution at your, shall we say, reluctance to comply wholeheartedly with his inestimable will.
What?
Stop doing evil, stop doing wrong, stop worshipping the Lord. We haven't got long, because in 40 days' time, what's up this town if he doesn't see a bomb just turns around?
They still stood still, everyone silent. Jonah was convinced they would soon turn violent, but gradually a whisper broke through the crowd, and together, the people shouted aloud.
Would you actually agree with what he's talking about?
You're absolutely right. Who spelled droughts? They threw off their silks, and they threw off their sashes, and prayed and repented, and sacked off and acted.
Agreed. We need to change our ways. God's word is true and it's here to stay.
The Lord was pleased with his resolution, changed his mind about retribution.
Sorted. So non-native brooch and you're up to rough, from rough to gem, from ugly and tough, to the best of best. To make him the shot, but remember, every time it comes from an ordinary rock.
So remember, every time it comes from an ordinary rock.
Yeah.
Thank you, Rob. And band, that was fantastic. And our God is a great God. Now, keep please putting on the comments what your answer is to that question. So why did so many people set themselves tasks or projects during lockdown? What do you think? It might be about yourself, it might be about someone else. And just put it in the comments box there. Thank you. We're going to pray together and the prayers are going to come up on the screen. Lord, let me know your love. Let my heart feel it. Let my mind absorb it. Let my tongue proclaim it. Let my eyes watch for it. Let my spirit long for it. Let it fill my whole being. Lord, let me know your love until I burn with love for you, until I am aflame with you, until my life reveals you, until my every action proclaims you, until I am one with you. Lord, let me know your love. And Father, we pray that your love fills each one of us today, that your Holy Spirit comes down and fills our lives. Lord, we pray that you speak to us today through your word and through the words that Andy brings to us later. We pray that you speak to us and tell us what you want us to hear. Help us to be receptive to that in our heart and in our mind. Amen. And we're going to start with a reading, which Edwin is going to read before handing over to Andy. Thank you.
This reading is taken from Jonah, chapter 1. Jonah flees from the Lord. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Then the Lord sent a great wind onto the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to his own God, and they threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. But Jonah had gone below deck, where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. The captain went to him and said, "How can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he will take notice of us so that we shall not perish." Then the sailors said to each other, "Come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity." They cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. So they asked him, "Tell us, who is responsible for making all of this trouble for us? What kind of work do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you?" He answered, "I am a Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." This terrified them, and they asked, "What have you done?" They knew he was running away from the Lord, because he had already told them so. The sea was getting rougher and rougher, so they asked him, "What should we do to you to make the sea calm down for us?" "Pick me up and throw me into the sea," he replied, "and it will become calm. I know that it is my fault that this great storm has come upon you." Instead, the men did their best to row back to the land, but they could not, for the sea grew even wilder than before. Then they cried out to the Lord, "Please, Lord, do not let us die for taking this man's life. Do not hold us accountable for killing an innocent man, for you, Lord, have done as you pleased." Then they took Jonah and they threw him overboard, and the raging sea grew calm. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows to him. Jonah's prayer. Now, the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights.
Good morning again. Although I can't see you, it's good to know that you're out there, and thank you for the answers to the question that you've been posting. Please keep those coming, even after the sermon. If you have any reflections on what I've said, if you disagree with me, it would be interesting to hear that. I think I may have agreed with Leanne prior to the service that she was going to say that bit, so I've gone off script. But from now on, I'll stick to the script. One of the stories that gets told about me when my family gets together involves Jonah. Apparently, there was this quiz at Sunday school when I was a little boy, and one of the questions that came up was, who was swallowed by a whale? Now, I was pretty sure that I knew the answer to this question. You know, I'd seen the film just recently, and I was dead certain I'd got it right. So I stuck my hand up, and when they turned to me, I eagerly gave them the answer, Pinocchio. About 20 years later, my church, Taunton Baptist Church, began to compare me to Jonah. You see, when I went to Russia in 1997 with voluntary service overseas, they were convinced that my real calling was Romania. They couldn't believe that Russia was where God really wanted me. So when three masked gunmen came to my door one night in Russia, tied me up, threatened me with death, and stole pretty much everything I had, bar the clothes I stood up in, and then that led me, as it would, to move to Romania, they were like, we knew. I mean, they didn't actually say right out that, you know, I'd gone off track to Russia and God had brought me back to the right path. It was just left as something that didn't need saying because it was so obvious. And so God took me to Romania. We go way back, Jonah and I, and that's probably true for many of you as well. It's a great story. We learn it as kids. Jonah ran away and was swallowed by a whale, and then he was burped up on the shore, and all of Nineveh repented. The end. But like many great good stories, it gets kind of twisted in the telling. We all know that Jonah ran away because he was scared, right? Except that's not what it actually says. The whale is a big fish, apparently. And Nineveh repenting is not even the end of the story, and possibly not even the main point. It's a very old and a very strange story. And you're probably wondering what it could possibly mean to us if you take away the neat moral about Jonah running away because he's scared and God putting him on the right track. I mean, what possible modern relevance could there be in a story about a guy who ends up locked away, hidden from the world, unable to go anywhere? I could go on, but I think I've made the point. Maybe it is a bit relevant to where we are now. If you think lockdown was bad, imagine spending it in the guts of a big fish. Speaking of lockdown, I wonder what tasks or projects you set yourself during those seemingly endless months. It was probably better than counting the ribs of a whale. But what did you do? Some time ago when he preached, Brian shared that he'd set himself the task of phoning a number of people every day. One of my colleagues commented recently that he couldn't bear to see any more homemade sourdough bread posted on Facebook. Redecorating supplies were gobbled up in the week before lockdown, and a lot of redecorating went on. Many books were read, many box sets were watched, and possibly most implausibly of all, I became lawn care guy. I'd never really shown much interest in the lawn before, and it showed. But suddenly there I was, raking, watering, sowing seeds, literally watching the grass grow. Now, some of this frenzy of home-based activity, I think, is simply down to the human instinct to make the best of the situation. you know, if I'm going to be stuck at home for 4 months, possibly with no work to do, people were furloughed, and millions of people were furloughed, then I'm going to need something to keep me busy. There's nothing wrong with that. That's not a bad thing at all. But I think some of this bucket list of lockdown stuff to do was also an attempt to take back the control of our lives that we lost once the pandemic got going. Some of it was displacement activity to take away the fear of the unknown, of the loss of so much of what makes up our everyday lives, of the suddenly all too present possibility of random illness and potential death. I've said that Jonah doesn't run away because he's scared, or at least that's not what the story says. So why does he run away? Why not just get on with what God has asked him to do? Well, one answer to that question could be this. It's because he too is trying to regain control of his life. I heard somebody say recently that Jonah reminds us that the idea that we have, that we are in control of everything, is an illusion. And the pandemic has shattered that illusion. Much of the fabric of our lives was suddenly stripped away from us with barely a few days' warning. Jonah doesn't want to give up control of his life, so he heads off in the other direction, literally the opposite direction. If Nineveh was to the east in what's now Iraq, then Tarshish lay to the west, possibly in Spain. Jonah thinks he's regaining control by getting as far away from God and God's calling as possible, but he just gets into a worse mess. And as I thought about Jonah and the mess he gets into, I thought about a guy called Shane Claiborne. Shane Claiborne is a remarkable Christian radical from America. He describes himself as a speaker, activist, and author. He's worked with Mother Teresa, and he founded a Christian movement called Red Letter Christians, whose claim is that they are trying to live, and I quote, as if Jesus meant what he said. I heard Shane Claiborne speak one time some years ago, and the thing I remember most vividly, apart from his dreadlocks, is this. He said, you know, most Christian speakers talk about how messed up they were, and then they met Jesus and he straightened out their lives. He said, my experience isn't like that. My experience is that my life was pretty straightened out and I met Jesus and he messed it up real good. Obviously, he said that with an American accent, so it sounded better. Jonah's in a mess. Shane Claiborne's in a mess, but they're very different kinds of messes. Jonah's in a mess because he won't accept the loss of control that embracing God's calling will bring. Shane Claiborne is in a very different kind of mess. It's not easy trying to live as if Jesus meant what he said. It can get you into all kinds of trouble, but at least you've accepted the simple truth that you're not in control. Now, it would be easy to conclude by saying that what we need to learn from this is that God is in control. I'm not going to do that. I might be wrong, but I fear that would just is a different way of asserting, a different way of seeking control ourselves. So instead, I want to remind us of one of the things that we learn at Christmas. Jesus is the man who, to paraphrase Shane Claiborne, lived as if God meant what he said. And when we celebrate Jesus' birth, we remember the name Emmanuel, which is used in the Bible about him. Emmanuel doesn't mean God is in control. It means God is with us. God is with us. God's with us in the pandemic, in lockdown, in hospital. in the supermarket, in the bus, if you can still get on a bus, in the traffic jam, in the queue to get into the bank wearing your face mask. God is with us in the mess, in this mess too. God is with Jonah too, but it takes a long time and a lot of heartbreak to break through. So as I conclude, I pray that your mess, whatever it is, will be more like Shane Claiborne's mess than Jonah's mess. And I pray too that you will remember, whatever the mess is that is your mess, that Jesus is the one who reminds us that God is with us. And with that, I hand back to Leanne.
Thank you, Andy. I wonder what mess you feel in right now. I wonder what control you feel you don't have over situations that you're in. Please keep sending in your comments. Andy's going to talk about those briefly later. And perhaps that's where you have a slight control over your life. But many of us find ourselves in positions and situations that we've never chosen. We don't want to be in, but we have to deal with. But we need to remember that God is with us. Whatever the mess we find ourselves in, whatever control we don't have, Jesus reminds us that God is with us. And as we respond to the words that Andy has brought to us, let's sing together Oceans as a prayer from our hearts to our Lord God. Let's sing.
You are mine.
take me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk on the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me when my trust is without borders. Let me walk on the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk on the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet will ever wander, my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Keep my eyes above the waves. My soul will rest in your embrace. I am yours. Yeah,
let us pray together. Let's bring ourselves and our thoughts before God. Dear Lord, we pray for our families, friends, and for all who are affected by coronavirus through illness, isolation, or anxiety, that they may find relief and recovery. Lord, hear our prayer. For those who are guiding our nation at this time and shaping national policies, and whose decision will impact our future, we pray for your guidance, that they will be able to see people and their needs and make wise decisions. Lord, hear our prayer. For doctors, nurses, and medical researchers, that through their skill and resources, they may bring an end to our struggle and to this pandemic. Lord, hear our prayer. For the vulnerable and the fearful, for the gravely ill and the dying, that they may know your presence, your comfort, and your peace. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for the isolated and elderly and fragile, that we may be alert to their needs and care for them in their vulnerability. Lord, hear our prayer. For our homes and families, our schools, our children and young people, and all in any kind of need and distress, we pray that they may know your peace, your presence, and your protection. Lord, hear our prayer. For a blessing on our local community, that our neighborhoods may be places of trust and friendship, where all are known and cared for. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the United States of America and their coming elections, for their nation that uses your name so often, for people who love you and worship you, that they may have a voice in this nation and challenge inequality, racism, hatred, that their presence may bring peace, kindness, acceptance and healing in this challenging time. Lord, hear our prayer. We also pray for all those places affected by coronavirus, natural disasters, human error and oppression. We name here India, Venezuela, Brazil, Lebanon, Belarus, that they may know your presence and find comfort in any hand stretched out to help, and any act of generosity, and any attempt to bring justice. Lord, hear our prayer. We bring ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, hello again, and I wanted to just cover off, as usual, a few updates and news for what's happening both at OBC and further afield. First of all, in terms of the use of the church buildings, there's no particular update this week in terms of that. So just to clarify, the buildings do remain closed at this point. The leadership team, however, are going to be meeting in early September, and we're going to review and discuss the next steps following the work that's been done by the church operations team to prepare us for a phased and trial reopening. And we'll communicate nearer the time what that's going to look like and what that means for folks. But a reminder in the meantime, as per the email and the video that Tom circulated a couple of weeks ago, if you're able to volunteer as a COVID steward, which is going to be essential to our planning, then please do get in touch as soon as possible. A reminder that Tom is on holiday at the moment. Some of you may have been following his staycation. Him and Ellie have been on in the north of England over the last week. Tom is still away until the 6th of September. So for any pastoral concerns, then please contact Marion Lamborn or another member of the leadership team. Or for anything else, please contact myself, and that includes any emails that need to go out to the church. A couple of advance notices in terms of next weekend. Next Saturday morning at 8:30 is the monthly prayer breakfast, and that's going to be hosted by Bill and Val on Zoom. And I'll be sending out a link later in the week as to how you can join that. But if you'd like to get involved in that but don't normally get emails from the church, then please do let me know and I can send on details for you. Also next weekend, next Sunday, the 6th of September, we'll be holding our monthly afternoon communion service at 4:30, and that's going to be led by Martin and Paula Jones. And again, we'll send out details of how you can join in with that, and that's going to be on YouTube during the week. So look out for that. In terms of refreshments after this service, we're going to be carrying on with that as normal, and it's a good opportunity to chat and catch up with friends and others across the church family. And this week Luke is going to be hosting that for us. So when we're finished, get yourself a drink and then head over to Zoom, where we'll be joining for that. And if anybody needs details of how to join that, then please again let me know. But the details were on the email, which you may have been surprised to see came out from Tom, but I can assure you he scheduled that before going on leave as to how you can join refreshments. And finally, I was going to wish my brother Graham a happy birthday. It's his birthday today, but given he's on holiday, there's not a lot of point. So therefore, if you are friends with Graham on Facebook, I thought it would be great if we could all just send him happy birthday wishes for his 60th birthday. Okay, well, he's not really that old, but if you all put that in a message, then it could be quite funny, and he's not going to know that I've put you all up to that. So I'll leave that with your conscience. So with that, before I just hand back to Andy, I just want to take this opportunity to thank everyone that's been involved in the service this morning. Thanks to Andy for his sermon, and indeed to the other members of the Brockbank family for their contributions. Thanks to Leanne for leading and organising us today. And last but not least, to Tim and Ellen, who have put together the technical details in the background and made sure everything's run smoothly for us. So from that, I will hand back to Andy. Thank you, Andy.
Thanks, Paul. And yeah, I'd just like to echo the thanks to Tim and Ellen, who on this occasion had to put up with my usual way of doing everything at the last minute. So I'm really grateful to them. Thank you to you for your responses to the question. It's been really interesting reading them and trying to, you know, kind of make sense of what people have said. I think I just need to touch first on the most liked comment, which was from somebody called Edwin, who said, I don't set tasks, my parents set tasks for me. Now, for those of you who don't know, Edwin is my son, so he's now in a lot of trouble. But that one aside, I think probably the most common theme was that we did this because there was time. There was time to do the things we normally don't have time to do. We've got a list of stuff or, you know, stuff that we want to do, and therefore having this time, we made time to do stuff. And yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's part of what I was doing, certainly. And then there was another one around giving some sort of shape and structure, you know, the things that we normally measure against have gone. So we give ourselves shape and structure and a sense of achievement in a different way. And then somebody else, in fact, there was a comment from Richard and Rachel saying, actually, you know, we're reflecting on whether God is calling us in a different direction completely. And I know that there has been some of that going on with other people during lockdown, people reassessing, do I want to carry on living the way that I was living prior to all this? Because change makes you reflect. And then I think Phil commented, people were in a productive mood. Yeah, you know, the way that we feel about the situation influences what we want to do. And then there was also a comment that kind of anticipated what I said in the sermon about it was a way of taking back control. And I think all of these are valid. Some of this is just instinctive. You know, I've suddenly got time. Wow, I can do all of these things that I didn't have before. So I think some of that it's just, you know, you take advantage of the opportunities that you've got. But I think also it reflects our nature as people that we need to have something to give us a sense of achievement. And that does ought to measure ourselves in how we're doing. And that is something about trying to regain some sense of control. So thank you. I hope you found that helpful. You know, happy to exchange emails further about this if anybody wishes to. I've enjoyed doing this morning, and I hope it's been helpful to you too. As we close, I need to pass over to Rob for the final song, which is Who You Say I Am.
Who am I that the highest king would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Through the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes I am. Christ, he has ransomed me, and his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. The Son sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Oh, I am who you say I am. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am. Who the Son sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Thank you, Rob. And thank you, Julie and Jane, as well, who also recorded that music. And thank you, Paul, for everything you've done towards this service. And we are ending slightly earlier than we normally do, which gives a great opportunity for people to join Zoom afterwards. So if you haven't yet joined with us to sort of see everyone and have a chat about life in general, then please do today, because it is fantastic when you see other people's faces on Zoom and just have a family together as one community. So we'll end with a blessing. God is always within reach. He is never far away. He is close. He is with us. He cares. He heals. He restores. He redeems. Go in peace. Walk in his freedom and his healing. May his huge grace cover you this day and forever. Amen.
There's no one like you. Unlike you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like.